than a hallelujah sometimes. God loves a drunkard's cry, the soldier's plea not to let him die. Better than a hallelujah sometimes. We pour out our miseries, God just hears a melody. No woman holding on for life, the dying man giving up the fight. But better than a hallelujah sometimes. It is a shame for what's been done, the silence when the words won't come. But better than a hallelujah sometimes. We pour out our miseries, God just hears a melody. Beautiful the mess we are, the honest cries of breaking hearts. But better than a hallelujah. Beautiful the mess we are, the honest cries of breaking hearts. Better than a hallelujah.
Amen. I heard that song differently this morning than I think I've ever heard it before. And that's a good thing. Thank you. I want to invite you to turn in your sermon notes if you choose to. We are now in part 5 of our sermon series on from Paul's letter to the church in Philippi. You may have heard of this letter is known as Philippians, and we are in part 5 last week. Next week will be our final week in this series, and we come now to kind of the overriding theme in this book. But before I get to that, some years back, my mother was moving out of her house that she and Daddy had lived in for close to 20 years, and some of you have lived in your homes much longer than that, but Mama had lived there for about 19, 20 years-ish, something like that. She was moving out of her home in order to move into a one-bedroom apartment. And some of y'all are cringing at the thought of that right now, because you can just imagine trying to condense all of your stuff into that one bedroom apartment plus a storage unit or something like that. But as Mama had been going through all of her stuff, I had been helping her over a period of time, but I went up to visit her, and Mama had three boxes of stuff, and it had my name written over the top of it. And Mama said that this is stuff of yours that I have found, and it's yours. I don't want it. So I was curious what may have been, and so I pulled out my pocket knife. I cut open the boxes, and I started pulling out all kinds of stuff. I pulled out box after box of old baseball cards. I pulled out a Ziploc bag full of pocket knives that I used to collect. I pulled out old trophies from my time in Little League. Some of them were because we won the league. Others were because it was just a participation trophy. I pulled out ribbons. I pulled out a certificate that I was given when I graduated from high school. You know what? I was voted. You know, some people are voted the most likely to succeed or whatever. I was voted the most likely to escape over the Great Wall into China. I still don't know what in the world that was, but I still had that certificate for that. There was all kinds of stuff. On top of the boxes was an old tennis racket. There was an old walking stick that I had carved when I was out in the woods on one of my backpacking trips. There was an old backpacking stove. It was basically, in a nutshell, it was my childhood, 18 years of my childhood, all packed away in three boxes. Now, as I was going through all that stuff, the memories came flooding back because as a boy, I spent countless hours playing sports, and I spent a lot of money from a paper route that back when they had newspapers and boys would have paper routes. Anybody remember a day like that? But I used to deliver newspapers, and I would spend the majority of my money that I earned on baseball cards, and I would spend a lot of time collecting and trading baseball cards. I would spend a lot of time on bike rides, riding my bike, or out in the woods, hiking and camping. The stuff in those boxes was a picture of my childhood, and it was a picture of what I used to value, that I wasn't all that important to me anymore. You see, it was interesting, as I was reminiscing, going through all that stuff, one of the thoughts kind of going through my mind was, what in the world am I going to do with all this stuff? You know, some of it I still have. It's still in those same boxes I got from Mom. The Apostle Paul could relate to those feelings that I had. Because earlier on in his life, that which was so important to him just wasn't anymore. We're now, like I said, we are in week 5 of this sermon series called First Love. It's based on the book of Philippians. And we're going to see a contrast it here in Philippians chapter 3. And the contrast is the way Paul used to be with how he is now. So I want to invite you to live, allow yourself to live in this contrast that Paul had lived in. Now, like I said earlier, and throughout this series, every week we have begun the message in the same way. We have stood and we have said together, and I've encouraged you to memorize these two verses from Philippians 3, verses 10 and 11. And if you haven't taken this seriously, please do. Please do. Say it over and over and over. Don't believe Satan's lie that you can't memorize something. It just takes repetition. Now, you know, I honestly have probably repeated these words probably 30 or 40 times over the past week. I'll be out walking Scarlet and I'm saying these words together and I preface it by saying, Lord, make my desire what Paul's desire was. And so I invite you to stand with me once again. You got the words in your bulletin if you don't know them. And once again, I invite you to place your hand over your heart because it's a heart issue. Will you declare your intention? I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his suffering, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection of the dead. You may be seated. Yes, these two verses, as we have seen, serve as an umbrella, kind of a banner over the entire four-chapter book of Philippians. It was Paul's desire. This desire is what shaped his perspective. It was this desire that enabled Paul, even when he was in prison, to have joy. Even when things in his life hadn't panned out the way he thought they would pan out, it was this motive, this drive, that shaped his perspective. It determined his priority and his passion. But here in Philippians chapter 3, like I said a minute ago, we see a contrast. We see where Paul used to be compared to where he is now. Now this morning, I'm going to do for you something that I oftentimes do when I'm studying Scripture. It was something I was taught when I was a student at Asbury Theological Seminary. And I was taught by my Bible professors, by my New Testament professors, when you're studying the Word of God, to break it down and to put a title of what you see and what you see in each of those paragraphs. And so I have done that over the years. This morning I'm going to do it for you. But the important thing is not my title. The important thing is what titles would you place there. So we're going to walk through. I'm dividing this passage into four sections. And I'm going to give you my title for each section. We begin the second half of Philippians 3, verse 4. Okay? We begin with the second half of verse 4, and we're going to read through verse 6. And here in this passage, in this paragraph, we see Paul's resume. His resume, if you will. Okay? Let's see what he has to say. If anyone thinks that he has reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal persecuting the church, as for legalistic righteousness, faultless. Now I'm going to go out on a limb and guess those words will never be a part of your resume. Okay? If I'm wrong, let me know. But my hunch is these words don't mean as much to you or to me as they probably did to a Jew back in Paul's day. Because Paul breaks it down. I mean, these words are very easy just to kind of read over, but let me give you just a little, quick little snapshot of maybe what Paul was getting at when he said, circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel. What Paul is basically saying here, I'm not a newcomer to the Jewish faith. I came from a good Jewish home. So good, in fact, that my mom and daddy, when I was 8 days old, they obeyed the Jewish law and they had me circumcised. It wasn't my choice. I was only 8 days old. But I came from a godly home, Paul would say. I'm not a newcomer to this Jewish faith. I'm part of the people of Israel. Not because I converted to Judaism, but because I was born a Jew. And who you were born as for a Jew, that was big back then. But Paul goes on. He not only says circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin. Now, if you know anything about Old Testament history, if you do, good. If you don't, that's okay too. But in ancient Israel, it was divided into 12 tribes. 12 tribes, the sons of Joseph. Okay? I'm sorry, the sons of Jacob. Had it wrong yet. Sons of Jacob. Okay? 12 tribes. One of those tribes, perhaps the smallest tribe, was Benjamin. In fact, the first king of Israel, King Saul, came from the tribe of Benjamin. Now, in Paul's day, some of the Jews, they didn't even know what tribe they came from. Benjamin, interestingly, was one of only two tribes of the 12. That means that 10 tribes, back after the rule of King Solomon, 10 tribes revolted. And they became part of what became known as Israel in the Old Testament, the 10 northern tribes. There was only two tribes. One was Judah. The other was Benjamin that stayed together. And they became known in the Old Testament as the nation of Judah or the southern kingdom. Again, Paul came from good stock. Not only that, he goes on. He said, he describes himself as a Hebrew of Hebrews in regard to the law, a Pharisee. Now, if I called you a Pharisee, would you take that as a compliment? Probably not. Because in our way of thinking, if somebody calls you a Pharisee, that means that you are more concerned about rules than you are about people. But in Paul's day, if you were called a Pharisee, that was a compliment. You see, Pharisees not only knew the law, they did everything in their power to keep the law. They were, as we might say, they not only talked the talk, they walked the walk. They were serious as a heart attack about what God was doing. Then Paul says, as for zeal, persecuting the church. You see, Paul, early on in his life, he wasn't one of those, and I don't mean this, but he wasn't one of anything by this. He wasn't one of those Christians who wanted to slip incognito into a worship service and then leave without doing anything. He was serious. In fact, he was so serious, he took extreme action to propagate what he believed. Okay? Paul's resume was impeccable. Back then, if Paul went to a new town and they didn't have a rabbi there, Paul could hand them his rabbi or his resume, and I bet you he would be chosen just like that. His resume was impeccable. But then we come to beginning with verse 7. From verse 7 through verse 12, we have my title is Paul's Epiphany. His epiphany. Okay, you've got the spelling for that in your notes. Let's see what Paul says. But, by the way, whenever you see the three-letter word but in Scripture, it means that something is fixing to change. That I'm fixing to go in a different direction than where I have been going. Those words that may just seem unimportant can be some of the most important words in all of Scripture. You want to know what two of the most life-transforming words in Scripture are? It's this, but God. The world says that you're a failure, but God. The world says this, but God. The word but makes all the difference in the world. But let's see what he says. But whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. I want to know Christ and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. It was Paul's epiphany. And I put in your notes that an epiphany is the experience of a sudden and striking realization. In a nutshell, it's when the spiritual light bulb comes on. It's when the light bulb comes on and you realize the things that you used to value really aren't that valuable anymore. It's an epiphany. It's an epiphany. I love a quote. The best I can tell, this quote comes from Thomas Merton. And I've shared this before because it's one of my favorite quotes, that we may spend our whole life climbing the ladder of success only to find out that when we get to the top of that our ladder is leaning up against the wrong wall. You see, Paul had spent his life climbing the ladder of success as a Jew, becoming a Hebrew of Hebrews, becoming as religious as the day is long. Religion. Now, in this passage, there's a couple of very interesting words. One is consider. Now, consider, I think if I remember right, it's used twice. Consider is actually an accounting term. Kind of look like this. That Paul took a piece of paper, so to speak, or maybe I should say, to be more accurate, a piece of parchment. And he drew a line down the middle of it. And on one side, he put the label up on top, good. And on the other side, he put the label bad. I'm not saying all of that over here. Don't worry about that. Okay? And on the good side, he listed all of the good things that he had done. Okay? He had studied under Gamaliel. He was a Hebrew of Hebrews. He was religious as the day is long. On the bad side, he listed all the bad things that he had done. And I suspect at some point in Paul's life, he probably had gotten to the point that he hoped and probably prayed that somehow the things on the good side would outweigh the things on the bad side. Isn't that how so many times we live our lives? Knowing that, yeah, I've done some bad things, but maybe if I do enough good things that they'll outweigh the bad things. By the way, it doesn't work that way. Because there's another very fascinating word in this passage. It's rubbish. And I'm going to get a little bit more descriptive in here than I did in the bridge. But the Greek word for rubbish is skubalon. I don't care if you remember that, but I do want you to remember what it means. Rubbish, skubalon, literally means human feces, excrement. Pardon me for saying this, God. You get the picture? You get the picture? Paul was using the most descriptive term that he could find to describe what he, at one point in his life, he valued so much. Now, it was feces. I consider them dumb. As some Bible versions say. Just those things that he had once valued so much. It was like he was taking all those things on the good side and moving them over here to the bad side, and by saying they aren't worth a flip. It was an epiphany. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection of the dead. That's why he could say that. That's why. But did you notice he says, I want to know Christ. He doesn't say, I want to know about Christ, but I want to know Christ. By the way, Paul was right on the same track that Jesus was in John chapter 17, where Jesus described this in John 17:3. He said, now this is eternal life, that you get to go to heaven when you die. Right? Well, if you're looking in your notes, that's not what it says. It says, now, this is eternal life, that they may know you. The only true God in Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. It doesn't say to know about Jesus, but to know him. What's the difference? I know about Ronald Acuna Jr. Any other baseball fans in here? I love baseball. I love the Braves. I will watch the Braves every chance I get. If Ronald Acuna Jr. is coming to bat, I will stop what I'm doing to watch him hit. He's got 10 home runs. Last night in the game against the Phillies, he was hit by a pitch on his left hand. You know, the first thing I did when I got out of bed this morning, I pulled my phone out and I checked my Atlanta Braves app to see how he was. But you know what? If he and I were in the same room, he wouldn't know me from Adam's house tap. I know about Ronald Acuna Jr., but I don't know Ronald Acuna Jr. You see, in order to know him, I would have to spend time with him, having conversation with him. Not just one day a week, and not just reading a little snippet, feel-good story in the morning, but knowing him. You know how else I would get to know him? By hanging around other people that wanted to get to know him. That's why we need one another, by the way. Okay? Paul's resume. Then we come to Paul's epiphany. Thirdly, we come to Paul's pursuit. His pursuit. Again, these are my titles. You can give them whatever titles speak to you. You see, for Paul, he wasn't after you and me to simply admire him for doing a good job. For Paul, Paul understood that just simply saying, I want to know Christ, he knew those were just words. Because Paul was about devoting his life to making that desire come to fruition. Listen to what he says in verses 12 through 14. Not that I have already obtained all this or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Paul understood that to really know Christ, it required a daily and a never-ending pursuit on his part. Pursuing Jesus. Think of it this way. A lot of people have a desire to lose weight. The desire to have a more healthy lifestyle and to lose weight is just a desire. Until that desire is coupled with a pursuit, you ain't going to lose weight. Having the desire is good, but that is just the beginning point. Because diet and exercise is the pursuit. We can say that we want to know Christ. The question is, are you pursuing him? The ultimate question here this morning is not really, do you know Christ? You know what I'm more interested in? Do you want to know Christ? Do you want to? Do you want to know him better? And keep in mind, Paul is saying, I'm not there yet. Not that I have already obtained all of this or have already been made part of it. Saying, I'm not there. But this is what I want. Here in this passage, like he does in other places in the New Testament, Paul uses athletic imagery. A press on toward the goal to win the prize. Picture, if you will, in your mind's eye, a runner running toward the finish line. And as they get close to the finish line, they're leaning forward to hit the tape. That's the imagery Paul has. A press on toward the goal to win the prize. Not just to sneak in by the hair on your chin, 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 but to win the prize. Now, we come to the last part of this passage. I'm not going to read it to you. I'm going to count on you to do that. My title is Paul's Pattern. His pattern. You see, Paul didn't tell us all this so we could worship Paul. He didn't tell us all this so that we could be impressed with Paul. He told us all this so that we could use it for a pattern in our lives. Miss Margie Campbell. One of the highlights of my ministry is coming out to visit you every several weeks. And every time I come out there, you are always doing the same thing. You are working on a puzzle. Okay? Now, one of these days, I'm going to trick you. And because there at your table, while you are working on the puzzle, you have the box standing up so you can see what you are hoping to put together. But when you aren't looking, I'm just warning you, when you aren't looking, I'm going to swap boxes. And I'm going to go over there on the corner, and I'm going to put the right box in the corner, and I'm going to move a wrong box, and I'm going to come over, and I'm going to visit you every day for the next few weeks, because, you see, if you're going to put a puzzle together, you need the right pattern, don't you? Paul gives us a pattern. You may want to circle the word pattern there in that last section. Again, the ultimate issue this morning isn't how well do you know Jesus. The ultimate issue, how much do you want to know Jesus? Because you may be like me, but you aren't there yet. But you aren't there. But do you want to be there? Do you want to know Jesus? That the desire God is looking for. I want to invite you to stand with me. We're going to sing together, God Will Take Care of You. But before we do, it's found on page 130. Before we do, I want to invite you, as you stand, to join me in prayer. Now I'm going to lead you. And I'm going to just invite you to get real, get honest with God, right where you are. Okay? And I'm going to ask that you repeat after me. Trust me. Trust me. Okay? Let's pray together. Father God, say it out loud. Father God, thank you for loving me.
Thank you for loving me.
And I want to love you back.
I want my
life to lean up against the right wall. Sometimes, Lord, I want to know you. Other times, not so much. But I want to know
you.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's sing together. Leaning up against the right wall. Come on.